here today. My name is Jean-Pierre Lacalbet. I'm responsible for marketing for Hewlett Packard for Europe, Middle East, and Africa. Excellencies, honorable ministers, distinguished guests, we are here for this opening session of the Innovation 2014 Summit. Throughout the next couple of days, we will discuss some of the key issues of infrastructure, connectivity, investments in technology for education, developing skills, curriculum and teacher training, among other key topics. So this ministerial panel is a great opportunity for our ministers here, present on stage, to give us their insight, some of the answers that they have found, and talk about their strategies for the next coming years, bringing technology to development and delivering better outcomes for Africa. So I'll start with a general question, a warm-up question, and ask the members of the panel. You know, there's a huge disconnect between the world of education and the world of work globally. This is true for Africa as well. And while many youth are unemployed worldwide and in Africa, employers still find it difficult to find the right talents and skill they need to develop their businesses and the economies. So is this just a matter of matching the right skills with the right opportunities? Or do we need to see more innovation in education to prepare the youth of tomorrow to deliver better economic outcomes for Africa? Maybe I'll start with you, Minister.
There is a disconnect between issues of higher learning, and the world of work. There are many things we can do. One of the things which I think we refer to in the rest of our countries is really to do labor market survey, to know what is required, and we target what is required. So we have to adjust our training programs according to the labor market demands. So that's number one. Number two, we find that a lot of times, again, there's no connection between our training institutions and the labor market. Whereas businesses, for example, who they produce cars, they market them. Coca-Cola still marketing their products. But we've seen our higher education institutions not be able to market their students. We train and give them degrees, and they are on their own. We don't even prepare them, for example, in terms of simple things like how you face the interviews, how you write simple letters for applications. What is available outside of it? So these are the things I think we really need to expand in terms of connection between us and the labor market. So we need also to bring the business or labor market into training institutions. For example, why don't we, when we are developing curriculums, Why don't we involve businesses to come and work with us in developing the curriculum? Not only that, when we are training and doing assessments, why don't we involve businesses in terms of monitoring the type of trainees which are producing? Number three, I think it's important that when the students are about to graduate, we bring the businesses to talk to our students, to direct them what is available, what's not available. So there's a number of things I think we can improve in terms of institutions of learning and also businesses. So I stop here for now, that I think I need to be corrected, so but we can talk more on the details on those things. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Minister. Minister Kokoku Agema, what's your perspective? Matching labor markets with education.
Yeah, thank you very much for the kind invitation and the opportunity to share. Definitely, education has come under a lot of stress in recent times. And I think the area that has suffered most is higher education. And the concern with higher education has been cost of education and then finally the output. Industry doesn't seem to be very happy with the products that are coming out because normally industry wants products the industry can use immediately. And education prepares for point, and therefore we need to have a meeting point between education and industry. So in the past, the comments have gone on. Universities will say, listen, we don't train for immediate work, we train for knowledge, we train for skills, and we train for students who are going to be innovative and adaptive, and you know, so it's been back and forth. Ghana's response, early this year, we held a very big conference. And at this conference, we brought industry, and we also brought the educators. It was a very, very interesting and eye-opening encounter. Because instead of each complaining in their own quarter, we thought let us all sit around the table and find solutions. And another partner at this meeting that was very, very useful were the students themselves. Especially when we targeted students who are looking for work, in order to find out what did they learn, what should they have learned, what skills would they have known. And the conclusions we are coming up with are very interesting. And some of them, I think my colleague has raised them, and I don't need to repeat. But my own take was that training needs to go beyond knowledge acquisition. It needs to go beyond skills acquisition. We now need to be interested in attitude. We need to be interested in values. And we need to be interested in dialogue. He has talked about bringing industry to help with maybe evaluation, curriculum review. You know, that kind of partnership will have to be much stronger. And then also for industry to know exactly what skills is industry looking for. Can industry, and industry is a very, very broad word. It's extremely broad and very, very complex for us to recognize that. So you pick industry, one, break it down. What exact skills are they looking for? And at that particular roundtable, it was very interesting to discover that industry itself sometimes also gets confused about what to expect. And I thought it was at that confluence that we found that lesson. So now we are partners and we need to work these problems out. I'll pause for now and then we can do it.
Thank you, Minister. Minister Lupo, what are you doing specifically in Uganda to understand what the requirements of industry and business are and match those requirements with the education curriculum?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Firstly, I do agree that in most of the African countries, there is a very big gap between what happens in the classroom and what is exactly available in the world of work. I will restrict myself to the interventions we are trying to make in Uganda. For instance, we have, in order to cure that problem, we have overhauled the lower secondary education curriculum to be in line with practical available jobs in the market. And we did that with the involvement of the private sector. So we are very confident that when we implement the curriculum at the lower secondary level, we shall be able to impact on the attitudes of the learners to accept that in the 21st century, we need to depart from the traditional way of thinking, from the traditional jobs that were there before, to what is now coming. Secondly, we have passed as government a strategic plan called Skilling Uganda, a 10-year strategic plan which is going to improve on the tertiary institutions, especially vocational technical institutions, where we think that when we finally create the authority, which we have already started drafting the regulations in order to make the law, we shall have 70% of individuals from the industry, from the private sector, participating in the identification of programs to be run in all our technical institutions, and also participating in the identification of training equipment that they would like to have in all our vocational training institutions. Besides, we have also made internship and apprenticeship in universities and higher institutions of learning compulsory. And we did that with engagement with the private sector, so much so that they welcome the students in their industries, in their companies, in their factories, when they are still at school, so that when they finish school, the students are conversant with what happens in the industry. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your remarks, Minister. Monsieur le Ministre, Anatole Colidé-Balonso, vous êtes ministre de l'Éducation civique et de la jeunesse. Votre collègue du Ghana mentionnait que l'école, l'université doivent apporter plus que du savoir, mais aussi une perception des comportements que l'on doit avoir en tant que citoyen et acteur de la vie civile et politique. Quelle est la perspective du Congo dans ce domaine ?
Merci beaucoup. Bon, je voudrais, si vous me permettez, avant de répondre à la préoccupation présente, rebondir un peu sur cette forme d'inadéquation que nous avons entre la formation et l'emploi, et qui fait que beaucoup de jeunes se retrouvent pratiquement au chômage après leurs études, et l'impression qu'on a que les entreprises ne trouvent pas sur le marché les compétences qu'il faut. J'ai parfois envie de dire qu'il s'agit peut-être que d'une impression. Parce que lorsque nous arrivons, pour nous, le cas du Congo, lorsque nous accédons à l'indépendance en 1960, et c'est le cas de bien d'autres pays, la priorité était de former des cadres administratifs qui devraient reprendre en main la gestion de leur pays. La gestion administrative, la gestion politique, la gestion sociale. Et donc, la priorité de la formation a été donnée, justement, à l'administration, a été donnée à l'enseignement, a été donnée à la santé, notamment aux services sociaux. D'où les programmes mis en œuvre au lendemain des indépendances. Et on a bien vu qu'on a formé beaucoup de cadres administratifs. Et des situations, l'enseignement, la santé, jusqu'en 1990, n'ont pas connu de problèmes d'enseignants, n'ont pas connu de problèmes de médecins, d'infirmiers, ainsi de suite. Donc, on avait résolu ce problème. À partir de 1990, s'ouvrent à nous d'autres défis. L'économie du marché fait effectivement que nous puissions privatiser beaucoup d'initiatives. Mais ce qui n'a pas été le cas entre les années 60 et 90, déjà, il faut comprendre cela comme ça. Et lorsque nous libéralisons les initiatives, l'entreprise privée vient avec donc des exigences et à ce moment commence à se poser le problème de la qualification de l'emploi de nos jeunes. Mais là encore, les questions sont relativement résolues. Mais le grand fossé intervient après les années 2000. Parce que nous connaissons à partir de 2000 une explosion de l'industrie, une explosion de la technologie, une explosion de bien entendu, comme je l'ai dit, de la technologie, de nouveaux modèles d'investissement. Et ça ne cadre plus donc avec la formation que nous avons donnée jusque-là. Et ça devrait donc demander, comme on le dit, autre temps, autre mars, ça doit demander une réorientation de la politique d'éducation. C'est un besoin qu'on vient ressentir vers la fin des années 90 et le début des années 2000, quand on se compare à d'autres pays. Et voilà pourquoi, à partir d'aujourd'hui, s'engagent de grandes politiques pour essayer de combler ce déficit de formation. Et donc, les résultats, on ne peut peut-être pas les avoir immédiatement. On peut supposer que, dès l'instant, la majorité des pays ont compris le phénomène, il y a eu peut-être un déficit de planification. Maintenant que le phénomène a été maîtrisé, on va aller vers une formation qui soit en adéquation avec l'emploi. Mais l'autre chose qu'il faut dire, s'il vous plaît, c'est qu'il y a aussi cette transition démographique qui fait que nous nous retrouvions dans notre pays, avec dans nos pays africains, plus de jeunes que de personnes âgées. Donc, la pression sur l'emploi devient tellement forte que même l'explosion démographique de la jeunesse, quand vous voyez la pyramide des âges en Afrique, la base est très large. Alors, cette explosion démographique ne s'accompagne pas au même rythme de la création d'entreprise. Et du coup, quand une entreprise a trouvé deux ou trois techniciens, je venais qualifié, mais il a comblé ses besoins. Si par la suite viennent 20 autres, 30 autres, ils n'auront pas accès au marché. Donc il y a d'abord cette compréhension qu'il faut avoir du phénomène. Mais là aussi, pour rebondir sur votre question et terminer, se pose, et vous avez eu raison de le dire, le problème de la formation de l'homme. Et c'est pour cette raison qu'au niveau du Congo, nous mettons un accent sur l'éducation civique, l'éducation à la citoyenneté, l'acquisition de certaines des valeurs morales, des valeurs éthiques, parce que ça aussi, ça mérite qu'un grand travail soit fait pour préparer les citoyens à faire face aux défis de l'heure, et pour qu'ils puissent faire face aux défis de l'heure, il faut qu'ils soient formés, éduqués, qu'ils bénéficient d'une formation à l'éthique, une formation à la citoyenneté, une formation civique. Voilà. Et donc, c'est vers cela, effectivement, que dans le Congo.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre. Madam Secretary of State for Innovation and Higher Education for Angola, how do you bring innovation to education to match those market requirements with the requirements of the country for development? In other words, how do you make sure that there is a perfect match between what the labor markets are expecting and the innovation you bring to education?
Muito obrigada. Esta preocupação é do governo angolano desde há alguns anos atrás, em que sempre se sentiu a falta de ligação entre os estudantes que saem, quer do ensino médio, quer do ensino superior, para o mercado de trabalho. O mercado de trabalho, desde há bastante tempo, alguns anos atrás, que reclama falta de qualidade. É assim que, desde 2013, o governo angolano está a implementar o Plano Nacional de Formação de Quadros, que vai até 2020. Este Plano Nacional de Formação de Quadros integra vários ministérios, é coordenado pelo nosso Ministério do Trabalho, e integra o Ministério do Ensino Superior, da qual eu faço parte, o Ministério da Educação, o Ministério da Ciência e Tecnologia, da Economia e do Desenvolvimento, Administração do Território. Este Plano Nacional de Formação de Quadros já identificou as carências de quadros que o nosso país tem, tanto mais que nos Ministérios do Ensino Superior e da Educação, Este ano já introduziram novos cursos, portanto, aqueles cursos inexistentes. E aqueles cursos em que há algum déficit, também já foram introduzidos novos cursos ou então foram aumentadas as entradas para esses cursos. É para referir que o Plano Nacional de Formação de Quadros é um programa que reúne, portanto, os ministros e os vice-ministros, grupos técnicos, reúnem mensalmente e estão interligados. Portanto, o objetivo principal é o alinhamento entre o ensino médio, o ensino superior e o mercado de trabalho. Também, nesse plano, temos um programa que é a empregabilidade dos jovens e o empreendedorismo. Portanto, nós estamos preocupados e quer o Ministério do Ensino Superior, quer o Ministério da Educação, têm estado em constante contacto permanente com as instituições que vão acolher esses formados para que possam realizar já os seus estágios de fim de curso nessas instituições. Então, nós pensamos que com este Plano Nacional de Formação de Quadros, o Angola terá, nos próximos anos, quadros de qualidade, porque o lema do Plano Nacional de Formação de Quadros é ensinar com qualidade e ensinar para a realidade de Angola. Muito obrigada.
Obrigado. Minister Lakwabamba, you alluded to the work that you're already doing in the private sector to match those market needs and the education. You alluded to the work that you've already been doing with the private sector and the work that private companies are doing with you in education. Can you elaborate a little bit more on this? Yeah. And the role that you see the private sector playing in developing education in Rwanda?
Thank you so much. I think generally we, a lot of our African countries, we believe that we have achieved access. But one questions ourselves, you hear the talk and when people say, are really our children learning? So we can achieve access, but if children are not learning as required, becomes a bit of a problem. So we are now to go to a different stage of having access with quality. And as you said, the first question which you asked, access also with quality and relevance to education. So it's very important that not only, as I said, involve the private sector in trying to reach relevance. But I think now it's about time we try to see how we can achieve quality with working with the private sector. There are quite a number of things which can be done. One of the things, obviously, is mobilization of resources. I don't think it should be under the job of the government to cover the cost of training of the human resource. This government has to put in quite a bit, but I think the private sector needs to be involved. Here, mobilization resources we look at, if you really want quality of education, we need good infrastructure. This is very important. You need good laboratories. You need good, you know, if, even if you talk about ICT in education, without infrastructure like energy, it becomes a bit of a problem. So the private sector can assist in quite a lot here. Learning materials, as I said, the experience which I saw last a few weeks ago in Nicaragua, which actually the private sector provide all these guidance, and the government also, maybe some of the government's supplements. So it's very good that it's very important that we involve the private sector here. And also we are now talking because when we talk of using gadgets, we talk about one laptop in Chinese. But if you look at Rwanda, for example, we have about 3 million students. If you want one laptop per student, you can't even have a problem with 3 million students. So we have to work with the private sector, for example, to create smart classrooms, which I think can help in increasing quality and so forth. And I think this will make a lot of sense. Issues of e-learning, issues of open and distance learning, which I think we can work with the private sector, providing some of these things. Some other things which I think is very important, which we can also work with the private sector. We were lucky yesterday that HP showed what they have done for Rwanda in needs analysis, ICT readiness. This was done by the HP in cooperation with us. I think if you can also work with the private sector to do a lot of data analysis, data gathering and data analysis, and like the HP has done for us, doing analytical and where we are, and I think that can make a lot of sense here. When you do a lot of analytical work, you can come up with relevant programs, you can come up with quality programs, and you can do what we call it policies, which will enhance these programs of quality and also relevance. So the private sector can also play a role in that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Minister. Very insightful comments. Minister Okukua Nyamang, in 2011, the government of Ghana issued its ICT education strategy and implementation plan. It's a very highly comprehensive document that covers all sectors of education, including investments of approximately $300 million to foster education, to increase the number of students and the number of schools. Can you tell us now in 2014, 3 years onward, what progress you have made and how much progress you see that needs to be done going forward?
Thank you very much. Our ICT policy document, first of all, seeks to inform our sector stakeholders the very essence of it. Because we know that we need to get buy-in into the document. So that is the first thing, and a lot of progress has been made. Right now, it's not so difficult to convince anyone that this is very, very important. And this is because we're able to explain the centrality of ICT to develop the requisite human resource for the entire country. And therefore, it's something that the whole nation needed to be part of. In order to make this happen, we focused on about 7 thematic areas. And these are education management, that is coming down to education itself. It's about management and management of all our agencies and ministries. The Ministry of Education has about 20 agencies in it. It's also about capacity building, the use of the equipment. It is about provision of infrastructure, and this is where we have partnered with the public sector, with the private sector, especially the telcos, in providing some of the infrastructure to make this happen. We are also very, very interested in equitable access, just as we are interested in incorporating the use of this into curriculum delivery and content development, technical support and maintenance, sustainability, even including disposal. We find all of these are important areas, and of course, including monitoring and evaluation. So we have come a long way, but we've also recognized that it is about the use of the equipment to a certain result or to a certain impact or outcome. Why do you need this tool? What problem have you isolated? And what problem is this solving? And how do you track the progress so that the resources can be properly targeted? Our key words in the ministry the last 3 years have been efficiency and targeting. For example, we have millions of children in the schools. I wish every child had a computer yesterday, but that's not the case. So that not happening, exactly what you do, what are some other practical ways of going about it? For example, maybe get every school a number of computers in a, you know, for them to use during certain lessons, which of them? How well have you prepared the teachers? That's capacity building. How about support staff? Okay. And which subjects? When we did our study of about 20 years performance, and it had been obvious all the time, but we needed to confirm it with the empirical data. Math and science was posing constant challenge, and therefore we isolated these two subjects. Okay. So how do you use the tool to teach the science? How do you prepare the teacher in training? How about the teacher out of training? That is pre-service, in-service, post-service. What strategies do you draw? What do you use to ensure that these tools are effective? Because we know that they are tools to provide specific results. They are not just fanciful items. And we know that by effectively using these, we are improving teacher delivery, we are improving the learning process, teacher knowledge and skills. We are looking at education management processes. The schools are spread all over the place. How do you know what is happening in every place? Do you wait for a report? Is there a map, a platform you can go on and get the information that is required? How about the quality of instruction? You know, my colleague talked about it. How do you measure how students are learning? I know that the Brookings Institute has come up, or maybe is coming up, with that kind of interest, and maybe we're looking forward to getting that. But we are also in country developing our own. Is it just an exam score? What else? Because I've talked about attitudes, I've talked about values. How do you qualitatively measure, quantitatively measure the qualitative? These are arguments and topics for research. And our ICT policy document is very sensitive to all of these and even more. So in terms of the progress, again, we have been able to reach many people, and we started with our distance education, and a huge emphasis was on teachers in the field. We didn't have our requisite number of trained teachers, especially at the basic levels, and therefore, instead of getting the teachers to leave their teaching and coming to the universities, which was not very practical for everybody, rather you take the training to them in the field. And distance education using these gadgets were very, very helpful. When we started, we didn't have them, but when they came in, we all saw how much more easy it was at many levels. Even as we were still very, very culturally sensitive, that face-to-face is also important. So it's a matter of a blend. In terms of that, I think that we have made some progress. We still have some ways to go, let me admit. And we are not talking only of the formal classroom style education. We are also very interested in non-formal education. We are extremely interested in technical vocational education. We are very interested in those who apprentice themselves very early on in life and who more or less are learning in these informal settings, automobile, whatever that they're doing. We're also very interested in reaching them with packages. We're interested in reaching them with new ways of doing things. And we, this is also where we partner again with the private sector. If all the cars coming in are of a certain brand, we need to partner with them. And so there are many, many other options.
Thank you very much. Minister Olubo, in Uganda, you recently made a ministerial policy statement in front of the parliament. And in this statement, you said that you wanted to increase the enrollment in primary schools and secondary schools, as well as universal secondary education. You emphasized the need to invest in science and mathematics. How does this translate in reality, and how does technology help realize this vision that you have?
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. As you may wish or not, Uganda, like any other African country, is implementing universal primary education and universal secondary education. In my recent policy statement to the Parliament of Uganda, it is indeed true, as you say, that I say to Parliament that we need to complete the gray areas which are in our education system in primary and secondary level. For instance, I presented a statement to Parliament that required them to increase resources in our sector so that government can call the so many sub-counties that we have, over 1,000 of them. We only have 273 without government-aided secondary schools, and out of the 273, there are only 96 without any form of government-aided secondary school. And you know, Mr. Chairman, that in Uganda, it is a policy that all secondary schools must have an ICT laboratory, which is fully equipped by government with computers and a trained computer teacher to teach the children of salaries, allowance, I mean, additional 30% of allowance to all science teachers in Uganda to motivate them. So when you're a science teacher in Uganda, you have additional 30% of your salary in addition to what you have, so that you can motivate them and encourage more learners to go to teacher training institutions to take on science subjects as their teaching subjects. Secondly, we also provide science kits to all our secondary schools, science kits to enhance the practice of children doing practicals. Key personalities move in schools to enhance the learning and teaching of sciences as role models, as individuals who have excelled in the world of work using their practical knowledge. This we are doing in order to enable the pupils and the students who are millions. Like in primary school, we have 9 million pupils. In secondary schools in Uganda, we have 1,500,000 students. We have 150,000 university students, and we have 80,000 students in tertiary institutions. The idea is to have a link, primary, secondary, and also university, so that we have a flowing system that the children should be able to know in all their stages of learning. And the idea is to let them know exactly why they are at school, so that they can have the reality when they finish school, when they face the reality of what they have already been exposed to when they are at school. We also have a program on universities of bringing secondary school children to do projects every year. And we partner with WEI in these competitions where the students do innovations and compete every year in terms of science, technology, innovation, and ICT. But Mr. Chairman, maybe let me say this, that in Uganda, we have been having a system of having centers for children who are trained in ICT, but we are looking forward to opening up to see how we can acquire computers, and in a phased way, maybe we can start with each teacher, computer for every teacher. We have 200,000 teachers in primary. We have 500,000 teachers in secondary. And we have a number of instructors in tertiary institutions, and we also have a number of lecturers. So we would like to delve into identifying a mechanism on how we can have software to have every stakeholder in education system have their own. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Monsieur le ministre, comment est-ce que le gouvernement du Congo entend matérialiser l'usage des technologies de l'information et de la communication dans l'éducation et l'encadrement des jeunes? On en parlait hier, vous avez des idées qui sont assez novatrices. Est-ce que vous pouvez nous les exposer, s'il vous plaît?
Merci beaucoup. Bon, nous, au niveau du Congo, partir déjà du principe que la jeunesse a une politique nationale, le gouvernement a une politique nationale de la jeunesse, et qui a quatre orientations principales, orientations desquelles découlent tous les axes stratégiques que nous mettons en œuvre. La première orientation, c'est effectivement développer dans la société congolaise une culture de relève. Et une culture de relève suppose qu'il faut former l'homme, pour revenir encore sur ces questions de formation, l'éducation et la formation. Et cette éducation devrait cesser d'être l'éducation classique ou l'enseignement classique, comme nous l'avions dit tout à l'heure. Il faut que cette éducation intègre les nouveaux impératifs qui sont les nôtres selon les temps modernes. Donc, la technologie, les nouvelles technologies d'information et de communication. Il faut donc, par ce biais, réduire la fracture numérique et permettre aux jeunes d'avoir accès à l'outil informatique, d'avoir accès à l'Internet. Et c'est le travail qui fait l'objet de notre plaidoyer en tant que ministre de la Jeunesse. Et à ce niveau, au niveau du ministère de l'Enseignement, par exemple, un pas vient d'être amorcé, notamment avec cette expérimentation de ce que nous appelons le cartable numérique. Le cartable numérique est ce projet mis en œuvre par le ministère des Enseignements qui est encore embryonnaire, comme je l'ai dit, c'est un projet expérimental qui consiste à mettre à la disposition des jeunes un outil informatique ou une tablette ou un ordinateur comprenant tous les enseignements, les travaux dirigés, les exercices. Et on l'a essayé avec un échantillon de 500 élèves dans différents départements du pays. Et l'idée est que nous attendons l'évaluation pour voir dans quelle mesure, dans les deux prochaines années, on va vulgariser ce cartable numérique sur toute l'étendue du territoire avec tous les enseignants, avec plutôt tous les élèves. Il faut partir du fait que sur une population scolaire ou scolarisable de 1 700 000 pratiquement, si je tiens compte de l'âge compris entre 6 et 24 ans, voilà, nous avons sensiblement 700 à 800 000 à l'école primaire, donc qui est obligatoire, et ça aussi c'est les efforts du gouvernement qui a rendu effectivement l'enseignement obligatoire jusqu'à 16 ans, donc jusqu'au premier cycle du collège. Et quand nous disons obligatoire, mais aussi gratuit. Gratuit parce qu'il y a la particularité au niveau du Congo, c'est que, bon, comme dans certains autres pays j'imagine, c'est que l'enseignement, on peut dire jusqu'à l'université, est un enseignement gratuit. Gratuit. Et même lorsque nous avons ouvert l'enseignement au privé, la régulation est faite de telle sorte que les parents qui acceptent d'inscrire leurs enfants dans le privé ne subissent pas le coût de la formation. Et l'État est obligé d'accompagner de sorte que le coût de la formation soit vraiment très modique. Alors, toujours pour parler des nouvelles techniques d'information et de communication pour les jeunes, nous profitons de ce que le pays bénéficie de la fibre optique pour nous permettre de réduire la fracture numérique et en faisant en sorte que nous puissions donner plus de possibilités aux jeunes d'avoir un outil informatique. Et c'est ce que nous allons développer au niveau du ministère de la Jeunesse en partenariat avec certains groupes que nous avons rencontrés ici d'ailleurs. Et nous vous remercions de nous avoir donné l'occasion, on remercie les organisateurs qui nous ont donné l'occasion d'être ici et de rencontrer, notamment sortir simplement de l'emprise de l'école, à part le projet qui consiste à doter chaque élève d'un ordinateur qui est en cours, qui est à l'étude en ce moment. Il faut sortir de là pour créer des centres communautaires d'initiation à l'informatique dans les quartiers, au niveau des maisons de jeunesse et de la citoyenneté que nous avons à travers le pays, de façon à donner aussi aux jeunes diplômés mais qui n'ont pas d'emploi, quand ils sortent de l'école pour promouvoir l'entrepreneuriat juvénile, on met à leur disposition un crédit avec les institutions bancaires qui permettent à ces jeunes de bénéficier des crédits pour financer leurs projets. Mais ces crédits, dans le cadre d'une action de travail volontaire que nous développons pour ces jeunes en fin de formation, devraient également bénéficier d'un ordinateur complet avec des programmes à l'intérieur d'entrepreneuriat juvénile, avec des programmes d'éducation civique, de culture démocratique, de culture à la citoyenneté, de culture entrepreneuriale. Voilà un peu, en résumé, la politique que le ministère met en œuvre en faveur de la jeunesse, tant en termes d'éducation, mais aussi en termes de réduction de la facture numérique, en termes d'initiation aux nouvelles technologies d'information et de communication.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre. Madame Secretary of State, you have encouraged students in Angola to foster economic development through entrepreneurship, to create businesses, small companies. Can you tell us what practical steps you're taking to promote this and how you bring technology and innovation to drive this entrepreneur mentality in the country for business development? This will be our last question. Thank you. Obrigado.
Obrigada. Tal como eu disse no início, nós temos também o projeto do empreendedorismo para os jovens, porque nós ainda temos algumas dificuldades de inserção no mercado de trabalho e é com este projeto de empreendedorismo que podemos então minimizar. Como é que nós vamos facilitar? Nós, a nível do ensino superior, temos incentivado todas as instituições de ensino superior a criarem laboratórios com computadores ligados à internet. Ainda temos algumas dificuldades em relação ao acesso à internet, mas nós temos o projeto de instalação do cabo de fibra óptica, já está em grande parte do território. Também estamos a criar o satélite angolano, denominado AngloSat, que será lançado no primeiro semestre de 2017. E estamos a crer que com estas ações nós vamos então interligar todo o país e não só. Em relação ao Ministério do Ensino Superior, que faço parte, nós estamos a criar a rede académica que vai interligar o Ministério do Ensino Superior com todas as instituições de ensino superior e vamos permitir que nessa rede académica, de entre outros serviços, haja uma biblioteca online. Portanto, estamos com estas ações, nós vamos então dar ferramentas bastante boas para que os nossos estudantes possam ter então um espírito de empreendedorismo e possam criar as suas próprias empresas. Nós também temos a ideia de criar incubadoras, mesmo nas instituições de ensino superior. Penso que com estas ações nós vamos minimizar alguns problemas de empregabilidade dos nossos jovens. Obrigada.
Very, very good point. Thank you very much. I think we've only got time for a very short video that will conclude this panel presentation. I'd like to thank the honorable ministers for their insights, very, very valuable for everyone. And thank you again. So let's roll the video.